These stories at the heart, I think they're timeless, you know, you can place them in any period.
I forget that I'm in a period film. Everyone's mannerisms are very modern. Everyone's just cool, like cool people that you'd hang out with now.
It was like a football game, like a boxing match. It's a major, major sport.
And the funny thing about it is the funny parallels it's running to sporting life today.
They are rock and rollers. We're in front of huge groups of people cheering.
My first impression was I was laughing and I was crying and I had to do it. And I was like, I have to play this character. I know him and I love him.
Someday, I'll be a knight.
A Thatcher's son?
You might as well try to change the stars.
Can it be done, Father? Can a man change the stars?
Yes, William. If he believes enough, a man can do anything.
William feels that in order for him to change his stars, that he has to follow his heart. And so he finds his opportunity.
We could do this. We can be champions.
William has to pretend to be a knight and to be a nobleman.
You have to be of noble birth to compete.
And to that end, he invents a fake identity.
So we lie.
In 1 month, we could be on our way to glory and riches none of us ever dreamed of.
But you can't even joust.
I think he's getting worse. He is getting worse.
I've waited my whole life for this moment.
We are the Burgess Merediths, sort of collectively. They're killing your rock.
We'll get it in the cradle.
Get it in the cradle!
And our rehearsals were basically going out to dinner with each other, having a few drinks, getting to know each other, which is extremely important because that friendship translated to the friendship that he'd created in the movie.
Easy boys, they're likely to think it's the first time I've broken a lance.
Heath has a very masculine quality that I think really helps him sell the character in the movie.
He can bring stillness to a scene. And to have the kind of confidence in your ability to do that is unusual for someone of his tender years.
Of course.
Heath's amazing, you know, he's 21 and he's a joy to be around. He's got his head on his shoulders. Sort of sense he has about himself, it's wonderful.
I was from Perth, Western Australia. I was acting from the age of 10 or 12, amateur theatre. I ended up in Hollywood and I did change my stars, I guess.
Jeff. Here's my lady.
Oh, jeez, you, William, you aim too high.
Oh, if there's another way to aim, I don't know it.
Concentrate.
What should I say to her? Your name, lady. I still need to hear it.
Sir Hunter, you persist.
Or perhaps angels have no names, only beautiful faces.
And you are?
Ulrich, von Lichtenstein from Gelderland.
And of course, when they're jousting for the favours of some of the ladies, that adds a different spin to the whole process.
Did she see me take the hit?
Yes, she saw you take the hit.
Or was she concerned?
It was dreadful. Her eyes welled up. It was awful.
Do you think he will come?
If I could ask God one thing, it would be to stop the moon and make this night and your beauty last forever.
It's William's first time being in love, and she obviously has never met anybody before, and if you're in love with somebody, you're gonna do what it takes no matter what.
Your name makes no matter to me.
Brian had told me about Shannon and said, you know, I found this girl, she hasn't done anything, but she's really, really good.
Right. Shannon was working as a DJ at the birthday party for Gwyneth Paltrow's brother, and casting director Francine Maisler talked to her and really liked her and asked her to come in and read for this movie.
Would you speak to me?
Speak. But sir, my sex are marked by their silence.
She knocked everybody out. She was just instinctually right on.
Oh, but I would hear you if it cost me my ears.
Yeah, that's well. For I do not want silence in my life.
Tell me your name.
Would you care if I were ugly?
Well, yes. I mean, no.
You could really see on film that there was good chemistry between the two of them.
Brian called me up and he said, you know, it's my pleasure to let you know that you're going to be going to Prague this summer for 3 months. And I just went, get out. I didn't believe him. And I feel like, you know, it hasn't sunk in yet.
I love the fact that Brian stuck on that, you know? He really wanted her because he saw the potential. He saw what she has inside of her and has been bringing that out of her ever since.
Sir Ulrich von Lichtenstein. I would have him win my heart.
You have to go to the banquet tonight. You have to dance. You have to make an appearance.
I don't know how to dance.
Sir Ulrich, why don't you show us all a dance of your country?
I'm asked to present a dance from my country land.
Show us a dance of Gelderland.
So I have no idea what I'm doing.
Well, you should bow.
And Lady Jocelyn, my princess, jumps in and claps her hands and kind of picks up where I left, and everyone starts to copy my dance.
It starts off as a stiff dance with the partner and the bow and everything very proper.
And halfway through, the beat switches over and David Bowie kicks in and Golden Years picks up.
And then everybody slowly starts boogieing a little more. Just mix it in as if you were DJing, and it actually works because you just start hearing the first few beats of the David Bowie song.
Don't let me hear you say lights taking you nowhere.
It's so much fun for me too, because I always was a dancer.
Nights are warm and the days are young.
Brian say, Shannon, you came to LA to dance, now you're dancing.
There's my feet, I lost that soul. Once I'm digging, you save a little soul.
She makes me feel like a poet.
Well, you may feel like a poet, but you sound like an idiot.
My dearest Jocelyn, I miss you. Was that wrong?
Well, it's up to you, really. It's your funeral. I mean, letter.
Brian's written a writer.
A what?
A what? A writer?
So he sees everything, as Brian does.
And you gentlemen are?
Well, I am Sir Ulrich von Lichtenstein from Gelderland, and these here are my faithful squires.
I'm Richard the Lionheart. Pleased to meet you.
I wrote the part for Paul. We had been friends, and when I sent him the script, he called me and he said, "You bastard." And I said, "What?" And he said, "I'm naked all the time." And I said, "Yeah, well, don't you think you can do it?"
Morning. Oi, sir.
There's a thing called a closed set where if people are naked, nobody comes on. What a closed set actually means is that people turn up in droves to come and see it. They turn up in droves. 250 Czechoslovakian extras staring at your old fella.
Geoffrey Chaucer's the name. Writing's the game.
It was fun to have a writer in there watching everybody, and hopefully you get the feeling he might write them all down in a story somewhere.
I like it.
He's Chaucer, but he's also part of Brian's alter ego. There's a brilliant line in it, which is, William accuses me of lying, and I say,
I'm a writer, I give the truth, scope!
I think that's really revealing.
Act as my herald and you'll receive a share of the winnings.
Done.
In tournaments, there was a tradition of having a herald announce the lineage of the knight who was competing, and Chaucer turns it into a chance to promote William, like a boxing promoter.
My lords! My ladies, and everybody else here not sitting on a cauldron!
John Lennon in front of the Queen, when they were performing Twist and Shout, he stood up and he said, everybody in the cheap seats clap their hands, the rest of you just rattle your jewelry. And I wanted it to be a bit like that, so it sort of appeals to the masses.
I give to you the one, the only, Sir Ulrich von Lichtenstein!
Now I got their attention. You go and win their hearts.
The direction that Brian gives is just insightful and quiet, and he just comes up to you and says two words and right, you know.
38B, take 1A, camera mark.
Rufus is explaining the rules of jousting to Jocelyn. He goes, oh, what am I doing in this scene to Brian? All it is it's exposition. And Brian went, no, it's sex position. And he goes, fine, I've got you.
Action.
1 point is awarded for breaking a lance on a man between the waist and neck. 2 points for breaking on the helmet. And 3 points for bearing a rider to the ground.
It's, you know, two heavily armored men with trees under their arms trying to hit each other's heads. So occasionally you'll have a couple of people not feeling terribly well afterwards.
I've ridden quite a bit socially, but no, I wasn't going to get up there and take the hits. I mean, these guys are crazy. They're crazy. And that's why when the visor goes down, my stunt guy's up there getting hit.
This is real. There's nothing fake about it. Yes, we use balsa wood lances, but they're getting impact. They're going to be dead manning where they come to the end of a cable and they're going to be pulled off. we're going to drag a guy with a horse. Every stunt is going to have something new.
This is very good. You see something else.
The lances are a constant nightmare, really, just the number of lances that we're getting through by the day.
There's no balsa wood left in the Czech Republic.
And they were hollowed out and filled with debris. Most of the splinters you see in the movie are spaghetti or different kinds of pasta.
We should have saved that last penny for the blacksmith.
The armor you wear, it wasn't made for you, was it?
So what of it?
I could make such armor you wouldn't even know you wore it.
It's too light.
He'll be crushed.
Are you all right, Will?
I didn't feel a thing.
And these guys went to battle for weeks in these things, and it's tough on your back, I tell you. My vertebrae are like this on my back.
I'll let the armor do the action for me. It's pure steel. I don't know how many pounds it weighs, but the helmet's about 30 pounds.
In armor's not sheepskin, you know, it'll never be comfortable.
When it's 100 degrees outside, you'd regularly have to have water poured on you, and you'd watch the steam go off it, because it would get like hot plates.
When he lifts his visor, you get a genuine sigh of a tortured person, which is great.
As much as he's a ruthless villain, Rufus is talented enough to bring a lot of sensitivity to him, and you kind of somewhat care for him.
How would you beat him?
With a stick, while he slept.
He's never been in a situation where he was in danger of losing before.
Neither has an anvil.
And it's often the case, you find out who you are in extreme situations.
And do men die in the joust?
The lance's points are tipped with colonels as blunts them. Of course, accidents happen.
And it all culminates at the end with the World Championships in London.
At last we'll have the chance to face each other again, Sir Ulrich.
I wonder what my father would have thought if he heard me being introduced as another man's son.
Who are you?
A knight.
A knight in your heart, but not on paper, and paper's all that matters to them.
Ulrich von Lichtenstein is not who he appears to be.
They're going to arrest you. A dozen royal guards.
You have been weighed, you have been measured, and you have been found wanting.
I love you. You run, and I will run with you.
No! I will not run!
In what world could you have ever beaten me?
The action is incredible. The comedy. The romance, everything. And it moved me in a way that I hadn't been moved, and I fell in love with it.
I have word of your son.
But it's about people's dreams, and that's what makes it universal.
He wanted you to know that he changed his styles after all.
And then by the end of the movie, your heart's like in your throat.
Change your styles. Let's dance, you and I.
Time after time, I've done my sentence, but committed no crime.
And
bad mistakes, I've made a few, I've had my sentence.